Good afternoon, everyone. I'm sorry for the delay. This was an emergency meeting. We were trying to wait for a few commissioners to get here. They had to change their schedules for today. But I'd like to call this special full board meeting on January 13th, 2017 at 3:10 p.m. to order. First call of business is a Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, will you please call the roll?
Yes, I will. Brown?
Here.
Calabelli? Absent? Drolet?
Here.
Duzé?
Sure.
Kleinfeld?
Here.
Kraft?
Present.
Leonetti?
Present.
Lucido?
Present.
Merchick?
Here.
Romano?
Here.
Sager?
Here.
Smith?
Here.
Toca? Epson?
Good. Thank you. Item number four, adoption of agenda. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Brown, supported by Sager. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion passes. Next is public participation. Any member of the public wishing to speak, you have 5 minutes. Please relate it only to the issues on the agenda.
Thank you, Mr. Smith, Board of Chair. My name is Joseph Hunt, 8306 Stanley, homeowner and taxpayer from the city of Warren, Michigan. As far as the sinkhole issue and the declaration of emergency, I'm in full favor of extending this on behalf of the for the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens of Macomb. I was over at the city of Fraser for a 2.5 hour meeting back in December, and the emergency management team was there. I counted the number of people in the room. There was about 100 people. And I guess the issue regarding this Christmas Eve day tragedy sinkhole issue comes down to that there was a determination that was made at the time for the city of Fraser to inquire with the Macomb County Emergency Management to take over the handling of that affair. And during that 2.5 hour time frame, there were a lot of heated issues. One of the things, there was a determination that was made of because there was going to be wet weather conditions, that there was going to be the actual dumping of raw sewage into the Clinton River, which made its way into Lake St. Clair. As this was a post-election transition period where the authority of the new commissioner did not take place until January 1st, I guess my question to this board, if there was any discussion whatsoever, as to who actually authorized the discharge of, it is my belief, 12 million gallons into the Clinton River in order to make its way into Lake St. Clair. But like I said, I'm in favor of the extension. I feel it's necessary. And also on the item of the appointment of Brian Santos to the Drainage Board, at the last meeting I was incorrect where I was saying it was the Chief of Finance. I was not up to date on that law that a charter county would be able to appoint someone from the executive staff, and I think Brian is a great choice. But I'll leave it at that. Who authorized the discharge of 12 million gallons into the Clinton River? Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else from the public wishing to speak? Anyone else from the public wishing to speak? All right, we're closing public participation. Item number six, the recommendation from the OCE to continue and renew the Macomb County State of Emergency Declaration until February 3rd, 2017 for the sewer collapse sinkhole emergency that was initially declared on January 5th, 2017 by the county executive. Do I have a motion on that? Moved by Kleinfeld, supported by Sager. Commissioner Leonetti?
Mr. Chair, if I may, I'd like to make an amendment to that motion. I believe our next full board meeting is February 9th. I believe the motion has us going until February 3rd. If we could, I'd like to make a motion to amend it to February 9th. That way it won't be necessary to have an emergency meeting like this again in case anything happens.
We have a second on that, Commissioner Majek. All right.
I accept that as a friendly to my motion.
Okay, thank you. Before we have any discussion on this matter, Marv, do you accept? Yes, I'm sorry, Marv. I acknowledge you.
I know you did, Bob.
Thank you. Before we have any questions on this matter, we might be able to clear up a few of the questions first on discussion. We have with us Vicki Wolber from Emergency Management. We also have Candice Miller, our new Public Works Commissioner. So Vicki is going to speak a little bit about the actual act, the Emergency Act, and then Candice is going to give us a briefing on the kind of the whole sinkhole situation from start until at least present right now. So thank you, Vicki.
Very good. Thank you. First, thank you all very much for coming to the special meeting so quickly to do this. Just for those of you that aren't familiar with me, just a little history because it'll tie in into the emergency declaration. But I've been with the county for almost 17 years now, almost the past nine as the director of the department. Before that, I was assistant director for the department. I actually, coincidentally or not, started my government career at the City of Fraser within their Public Works Department, and I also did emergency management for the City of Fraser. So collectively, I've had almost 25 years within the emergency management field, and as such, I've never had to ask for a continuation or a renewal. So it's somewhat a new process for myself and our office. Generally, most emergencies that we deal with, relatively last a few days within that first 7 days that is allowed under the declaration. No two emergencies are ever the same, even if they're caused by the same type of event, such as a flood, which we've had several of in the county. And this is our first sinkhole that I've been involved in actually county emergency management. So obviously we put our initial declaration in last Thursday through the county executive, which follows the law. And then based on the circumstances of the event and this ongoing threat that we've been talking about, that while the sinkhole itself appears to be, what you may want to call stable at this time, there's many varying factors that could change that. And that includes weather conditions, the soil, could shift, the sinkhole could collapse further, some of the emergency equipment out there could fail. And the long-term emergency bypass system is not due to be fixed and in place until the end of January, beginning of February. So for that reason, the emergency period is really longer because we obviously don't want to, one, discharge into the Clinton River, or two, cause sewer backups affecting close to 500,000 people in the county potentially. So in discussions with the state, we went back and forth on whether we were covered under their state declaration or not, which expires February 3rd. And in some aspects we are, for all the funding that we're doing, resources from the state. But when we took a look at it and the language and some of the things that we want to keep in place for the duration of the event, the decision was made and a recommendation made to the county executive's office to come to the Board of Commissioners and ask for that renewal or continuation. I can tell you I picked February 3rd just because that was the date that the state's declaration ended. So I think Board Chair Smith, my office was contacted about the possibility of extending that to the 9th. And there are no legal concerns, no funding issues extending it, and it makes great sense for how the board works and the time frames.
Vicki, if you wouldn't mind staying up there, I'd like maybe people could question you on maybe the Emergency Act itself, and then anything pertinent to a sinkhole, maybe we'll wait until Candice Miller speaks on it. Do we have any questions? Mr. Commissioner Drillette, Mr. Brown on deck.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, through you. What are the limitations in extending this? I mean, could we extend it a month, a year? Are there provisions that restrict how we can extend the state of emergency?
There's none that I'm aware of in reading the law. I think last night, Clinton Township Board meeting, I think initially their recommendation was to do it indefinitely. I don't know if they switched that or not. But really, the way I read the law or see it, there's nothing that says it can only be renewed for another 7 days or another 14 days. It just says that after that first 7 days that we need to come back to the board.
Just one quick follow-up, if I may, Mr. Chair.
Yes.
Thank you. And is there any new requirements by
the county to continue this emergency declaration? Is there anything we have to do besides extend it to financial?
doing what we've been doing in my office. We've been involved since Christmas Eve for the entire event. Obviously, we made the recommendation and asked the city of Fraser to declare. So we've been involved all along. Once the county declared, though, that's really where a lot of our provisions kicked in. We have to start meeting certain time frames with submittals, getting information into the state. We have an electronic reporting system that we're using now. All of that would essentially continue under the state declaration. So really, the county declaration is just making sure that all of our resources are in place and that we're ready to go should something happen. How I can kind of term it is if we didn't have the extension, and let's say midweek next week, something happened, and we want to declare, we have to declare again, and you know, we just have to go through the process of getting a hold of the county executive, writing it up, things like that. So this way, it just puts everything in place and doesn't have us miss a beat.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Commissioner Brown, with Commissioner Sauger on deck.
My questions were answered.
Thank you. Commissioner Sauger?
Yeah, Vicki, I just want to say, of all the years I've been on the board and worked in this county, we've never had a sinkhole before. And I was amazed how quick the departments, you, Public Works, how everybody got together and do something about this, just like overnight. And you got to pat you all on the back for what you did.
Oh.
It's a tough job, it's a long way to go, but I've never seen nothing like this before.
Yeah, like I said, I've never gone through a sinkhole before, and yeah, everybody's been great from the response from Fraser Public Safety and Public Works. Obviously, County Public Works was on the scene, the engineers, the contractors. It's been a wonderful team effort and continues to be. And, you know, they've been working 24/7, you know, since Christmas Eve, and, you know, everything happened simultaneously. There's probably four or five major goals, and it's not like you finish one and move on to the next. It's all been happening simultaneously, and I think it was maybe on the Monday after Christmas, I said I've never seen so much equipment, so many contractors out there, so many people, even between all the utility crews, all the lines being drilled underground. So it's been a very good and thought out process from everyone involved. But thank you.
In conclusion, you found out who your friends were. Thank you.
Yes, as you always do. Yeah.
Thank you, Commissioner Sauger. Commissioner Majek.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks for calling here, Vicki. Just one question. As far as the state government goes, where would potential monies come from? Which department or agencies from the state government would we be getting funds from in the future for this?
Sure. Right now, through strictly through the emergency management process, they do have a provision in state law. It's called Section 19 funds that we believe will qualify for that based on the amount and the type of damage that we have. I can tell you that that's limited, so it's not a large portion. But because we declared and then the state declared, we know that there are funds through the Federal Highway Association and through MDOT that will come through the Road Commission or Road Department, excuse me. So we're working on those with Brian Santo. He's been involved. And then there's other sources through Public Works Commissioner Candice Miller that we've talked about with the governor's office as well that aren't through the normal emergency management process, but that might be available to us as well, both at a state and a federal level.
So as I've been reading this, Candice Miller has mentioned that this could potentially be as high as $100 million, worst case scenario. Regardless of that, there are a lot of different agencies and levels of government where we can get potential money for this problem, that I guess.
Correct.
And I will hear from you after, Candice.
Yep.
Okay, thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Dujayan.
Thank you very much. I'm looking forward to Public Works coming up, the Director of Public Works. Question, will any of this money, and go back to Commissioner Majak's question, is any of this money going to need to go through our finance department? Are we going to be voting on any of this? Are we getting involved in any of this? Where does our... where do we begin and where do we end with this as far as the emergency management system and so on and so forth?
I'll have to say I think it's a little too early to tell since we don't have all of those areas identified of where the funding's going to come from. A majority of the funds that we get through the emergency management process and the Section 19 funds that I talked about, it's obviously on a reimbursement basis, and most of those will come for items that have already been expended. I can tell you a lot of times they cover, you know, within the first 48 to 72 hours of the actual emergency response. So you're looking at wage reimbursement, overtime that county departments have it expended. You know, it might touch into some of the contracts that came into place. So for that piece, it would come back, you know, as a reimbursement. Potentially, they sometimes do it as a grant that comes back in. But it'll really be reimbursement based.
So going along further down the line, this has the potential of showing up during our finance meetings and so on and so forth for allocation or reallocation of funding.
Potential. Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Commissioner Duje. Commissioner Romano.
Thank you, Chairman. Just one question, if I may. This started on December the 24th, which was Christmas Eve.
Correct.
And everybody was on board as of December the 25th, as far as the contractor. So now we're 3 weeks, almost a month into it. Do we know thus far what we've had in expenditures? Do you have any idea what we've spent so far? I say we because we're all in this together, but is there any amount that you have in or figures available that say thus far we've spent X number of dollars?
I don't have the specific figures on what we've spent. We do have better numbers on the overall total of what they're estimating the project to be, and that's right now close to $67 million. From the various departments and agencies that are involved, if you look at going back to the overtime, that's easy to calculate since people are getting paid. We have figures from Fraser Public Works, Fraser Public Safety, the Road Department, and County Public Works. Between those agencies, I can tell you that's probably close to $100,000 right now. And then the remaining funding sources right now are all part of AEW and the project management that's going on continuously. But we're going to keep working those numbers. That's one of the items that we have to continually update the state with now that we've declared. So, you know, everybody is, you know, doing their certified payrolls as Commissioner Miller has asked for and to have them keep doing that and start tallying all their bills. So,
thank
yes.
you. That's all I have. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Leonetti.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
One of the questions I had, I think, was answers. It was how much money have we spent so far? Is there a breakdown that you can give us on how much the county has expended at all at this point out of that $67 million figure that you were talking about? Any idea what percentage?
The majority of it is county funds.
Okay.
Yeah.
Follow-up question. There is a system I heard about. I pretty much heard about it from the newspapers. There's an electronic monitoring system for the employees, the contractors that are there. Can you elaborate a little bit about that?
I cannot, but maybe Commissioner Miller can of what
okay.
she's asked them to do. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You're
Thank
welcome.
You, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My question relates to the county's contracting policy. We have a contracting policy that the county follows, and wondering how that intersects with the drainage district that may be paying part of these costs. And we don't expect to have that answer now, but that would be something that I'd like to look into as we go forward here to see how those two intersect. And because obviously a lot of money is being spent, and we have a policy that we have to approve contracts over a certain dollar amount, and I want to remind you of that from your standpoint as a county department purely. So I'll toss that out there. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. We will certainly stay on top of all this. Anyone else on the first round? Commissioner Drolet on the second round.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. But the $67 million you said is a possibility or maybe a likelihood or whatever they might be, comes to about maybe $75 per human being in Macomb County, which could be, you know, obviously a lot for a family. How much of that do you think is a best case scenario we might be able to get assistance with from the state or the federal government? Is there a percentage?
I couldn't even offer a guesstimate at this time with the information that I have. because it's still everything's still in play. You know, we just got an email before we came to this meeting about potential resources that are out there in grant funds. So no stone is going unturned, I can tell you that.
Is there somebody I should may know that question? I don't know if
Are you finished, Commissioner?
I am. Thank
okay, thank you. Any other questions for Vicki? Well, thank you very much for being in front of us. Our newly elected Department of Public Works Commissioner, Candice Miller, welcome to our meeting.
Thank you
for coming.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, all of you commissioners. I'm delighted to be here. And congratulations to you as a new chairman of the County Board of Commissioners. And congratulations to all of you for being here. And honestly, I did not think this would be my first time in front of the County Board of Commissioners talking about the sinkhole. But I'm delighted to be the new Public Works Commissioner here in Macomb County. And I will tell you that this is an enormous thing that's happening to the county. But we're all up to the challenge. We're up to the challenge, this county. We're going to get through this thing. We're going to solve this problem. And somehow we got to figure out how to pay for it. So, and my numbers are a little bit different than Vicki's, so I'm not to correct her, but mine are a little bit higher than that, actually, so we're trying to pull all this together. But just in a brief overview, and you've all seen, I'm sure you're following in the news what is happening, and we have extended an invitation to all of you, certainly got the emails this morning, and on Sunday we'll be having an event where you can all come and get the engineer brief. Our plan is, we call it the CODEL, the congressionals are coming, both our United States Senators, Sandy Levin and Paul Mitchell, the two members of Congress from Macomb County. Some of the state delegation will be there, and certainly extended an invitation to all the Board of Commissioners as well, where you'll get a brief from the engineers on site. You'll be able to ask questions, and I'm sure there'll be a lot of them, and then you can walk the site, which I think is an important thing, because I'm going to tell you, you can look at the picture as much as you want. You cannot believe this thing until you're standing there. It is really it's an enormous undertaking. It looks like a big construction zone with a huge sinkhole in it, which is exactly what we're looking at there. So this sinkhole, as was mentioned, began on Christmas Eve, it is the mid, that's what we refer to it. This stretch of pipe is the mid, which is the Macomb Interceptor Drainage District. And it's under the Public Works Commissioner's purview, which is the umbrella for 11 of the Macomb County communities. So every community in Macomb is not in it, but 11 communities, you all know who they are, and including Selfridge, our National Guard base. This thing has had a very dubious past, because there was a sinkhole in 78, there was another sinkhole in 04, and now we have this one happening again. And it's really the same stretch of pipe where this sinkhole is happening. And this is an 11-foot diameter pipe. This interceptor is enormous. There are about 530,000 people whose waste goes through this interceptor, as well as about 46,000 businesses. So probably over about 600,000 people are flushing their toilets through this thing every day. So it's huge, it's enormous. And what is happening right now is we're really trying to, and they have, as Vicki said, first hats off to all the engineers and the contractors and our personnel who have been out there in some extremely challenging conditions. The weather conditions have not been great, and obviously the thing itself is just trying to get your arms around it, what is happening, why it's happening, what we have to do to stabilize the situation. So they are in the process, in the immediacy right now, of building a temporary bypass, which will be, the construct of that will be about 6,000 feet, three parallel pipes. Obviously, you can't put 11-foot pipe on 15 miles, so they're doing three. I think they're 36 and a 42-inch pipe, parallel for about 6,000 feet, and then this will probably take another 2 or 3 weeks, it could be a month, to build this and have it ready to stop the flow, if you will, in the interceptor and put it in the temporary bypass. And as that happens, once that happens, we will actually be able to understand the scope of the sinkhole, get under there and see it. Right now, it's essentially a football field going both directions. And also the situation with the pipe of what has happened and what the construct of the fix is going to be. But the expense is staggering. And I don't get flustered very easily, but I'll tell you what, looking at these numbers makes you pause. it makes you pause. And actually, the estimate that we've had for the first portion of this is about $78 million, is sort of what I had seen. These are very preliminary estimates. And that does not include, if you want to really fix this thing, the entire length of this, you're looking well north of $100 million. And I guess that's something we're all going to have to decide what we want to actually do here. I'll tell you one thing. I personally do not want whoever is my successor to be standing in a sinkhole in 15 mile in 10 years from now. So we really have to look at this. And I think we all understand, actually throughout the country certainly, but in so many areas, we have just as a society probably not invested enough in our underground infrastructure. For all kinds of reasons, right? I mean, you run into a pothole, you see it, you feel it, you know you have to fix it. But this is out of sight, out of mind. But yet it is something that is so important for our quality of life and for us to live properly. So at any rate, they're building this temporary bypass. They are also sort of bookending this sinkhole with what they call grouted pillars. And there are a number of them now, and they might have to put a couple of rows of them. And that essentially stabilizes the soil so that the sinkhole does not continue to migrate. So they're trying to do that. They're also dewatering this area. I think they've got 22 of 26 dewatering wells that are happening. We're sort of trying to pull the water out of this area so that it's not all infiltrating into the pipe. You keep hearing us talk about asking the people in the 11 communities to restrict their water usage. This is very important, and we've had some great success with that, because we have not had to discharge since the initial discharge, where they discharge raw, as was mentioned by one of the residents, almost 13 million gallons of raw sewage went into the Clinton River on Christmas Day. And the choice then was you're either going to dump it in the river or you're going to back up into people's basements. And not much of a choice. Obviously, you have to dump into the river. But we never want to discharge in the Clinton River. And one of the things that we have done now is we have actually put disinfected, so we have product at six strategic locations at where we might have to pump if we have to discharge, which is a constant threat. So far, we haven't had to do that again, but we've had a little bit of rain, not much. If we have a heavy rain, we're going to be back into this, probably a discharge. And so we have disinfectant product available to disinfect with booms and everything, so we can do our very best job with this as we have to, if we do have to do that. And then we'll have the availability of also doing real-time testing. If there's any residual chlorine, if there's E. coli, whatever, we'll know what we're doing, which is not going to be good. But hopefully it'll be much better than raw. The street, Eberline Road there, I know you've read all of this, but we had to evacuate 20 homes there, actually 23 homes. 20 of those homes, those folks have gone back to their homes. So we've built a temporary bypass. We had to, you know, get an easement that we paid for at the next to the strip mall. Fortunately, the guy had a vacant lot there, so we've constructed a ingress-egress, something they can plow, get the emergency vehicles. So those families have been able to get back into their homes. Unfortunately, there are three families, very unfortunately, who are never going back into their homes. These houses have been condemned, and I know that some people say, well, you know, you've got governmental immunity, we'll just see how it all works out. I personally don't think that's the right approach. First of all, you don't buy insurance for a sinkhole, you know, maybe in Florida, but not in Michigan, certainly not in Fraser, Michigan. So we're trying to figure out, and we're in the process of doing appraisals right now, if we can come to an agreement with these folks to actually have the county, the MID, I should say, that's the MID, purchase these homes. And so that's one of the things that we're looking at there. Let's see, what else did I want to tell you? Oh, the MID was bought in 2009, and talking about the history of this thing, whether or not that the pipe should have been bought is in question. I've been told that this was purchased over the objections of some of the engineering staff in the Public Works Department, but for whatever reason, there was a decision to buy this from the Detroit Water and Sewer Department, and so we own it. And they were bought in 2009, and in 2010 there was an inspection done, and there hasn't been another one done since. Whether or not this should have been inspected more, we're looking at the inspection logs. I mean, there's lots of things that you can start pointing fingers at, but really what we need to do is think about how we're going to fix this thing long term. And there are a couple of theories of why this happened, and I guess I would just mention that, and then I'll be available for questions. This is only a theory. Only a theory, and we won't know until we actually look at it. But it's interesting because one of the engineers brought this. We started, you know, really sort of dissecting, if you will, the logs, the inspection logs and that. I should have brought this map here because if you look at this length of pipe, right within this area here where these sinkholes have been, in 79 there was a contractor who drilled some holes in this pipe to check the integrity of the pipe. So this contractor drilled 11 holes in one section of this pipe, and the holes are about 2 inch in diameter on the top of the pipe and then the bottom of the pipe. And then he drilled two other holes, one upstream and one downstream. And if you look at where these 11 holes were, that's where the first sinkhole was. That was the first collapse of this pipe. And if you look at the other one upstream, it is right in the middle of the box of where the sinkhole happened in 04. And if you look at the other one, it is right in front of the home on Eberlein Drive that's going into the sinkhole. So it's a theory. But if this is the theory, potentially, what has happened is, you know, these small holes, the silt under this, the ground there is bad. The soil conditions are very poor. I mean, people, you know, you've got running sand going on there. You could have had old riverbed down there. And then there's a clay, good Michigan blue clay on the top of this pipe. Too bad it's not underneath. So as this thing could have been going on for, you know, this is 40 years ago they drilled these holes. Who knows? So you have these little holes, and the silt gets into these holes, and the thing starts, you know, the sewer, it's going for how many years? Pretty soon you have, underneath, there's no support of the pipe. Now you have this clay liner on the top. The thing collapses, and the sinkhole is happening. We think. Again, that's just a theory. So we'll see. But, you know, you might not even be able to decide when you look at it whether or not that actually is what happened because of how bad the break in the pipe must be. So how do you fix it? And I know I'm going on here, but just to give you an overview. The best way to fix it now, this pipe is a concrete pipe. It was not reinforced. There's no re-rod in it. You know, back in the day, who knows, whatever. But now there's very significant technology for lining the interior of these pipes. It's actually called Hobas, which is the name of a company, but they have the patent on this particular. It's like a polymer that is stronger than concrete, and it's unbelievable stuff. And if you were to line this pipe, it's very expensive, but you will strengthen the pipe. You will have the extend the length of the pipe. It could be for a couple hundred years, they say. I mean, it's unbelievable product. It's very expensive. So we know we have to fix at least this stretch of it. But if you really want to fix this whole pipe, now you're talking well north of $100 million, probably, is what they're telling me. So I know that's not what any of us want to hear, but something has to happen here. So we're going to be, and I appreciate the working with Vicki and everybody, this emergency declaration gives us at least the vehicle that we need to try to access some other funds other than just floating a bond issue. We've already met with bonding attorneys. We're starting to talk about what we have to do from a financial standpoint here. We're probably going to do a short-term bond, maybe a long-term bond, because we need some immediate cash for many of the expenses here. But there's a potential of some state funding, maybe, or at least through the state revolving fund, where that's the interest rates right now, depending on the cycle of the state revolving funds are between 2%, 2.25%, maybe 2.5%. Still, it's low, it's cheap money. There's a potential of, through, as Vicki mentioned, the federal highways, perhaps, to help us with the reconstruction of 15 Mile Road. There may be a potential of what they call WIFIA grants, which is through the EPA. And we're going to work that. And you can believe me, I'll be asking all of our congressional delegation on Sunday to help us with that. And so we're just going to look at every source of revenue. But there is no guarantee of any money at all. We should start with that. I mean, I've talked to some folks. I used to be on what we call the TNI, the Transportation Infrastructure Committee in the House. I've talked to some of them. They said, well, you know, yeah, that's too bad that's happening to you. But we've got problems in our state, too. So I don't know how we're going to do here. They don't earmark anymore in Congress, and we'll just do our best. But thank you all for listening, and we look forward to hosting you on Sunday, and you can really get a good firsthand view of the magnitude of this.
Great. Thank you very much for that update. I'm sure there might be one or two questions for you. Commissioner Brown has expressed interest. Commissioner Brown?
Thank you.
Welcome, Commissioner Miller.
Thank you, Commissioner Brown.
How much cash is available in the district, into that OMED district, to help you with working capital? Do you, that was always been a question. Of, it's always a, you know, don't know if you're opening a box full of cash or it'd be, you know, receipts. How much money do you have to work with existing now?
About $5 million. But, I mean, we haven't expended a penny yet. And I mean, we're so far over that already. But we that's about what we have in there. We have the potential for, I think, about $7.5 million through the course of the year as ratepayers are paying their bills. So,
And all these invoices are being attracted by your department, I mean, in terms of the
Well, what happened, obviously, initially, and even now, we're still in this emergency mode, right? People are just flying around and everything else. And as soon, I'm going to tell you, the first day I was out there, I said, well, this is, listen, I appreciate everybody, what everybody's doing here. But we're in this emergency mode. Everybody's very emotional right now. But I can tell you, in 6 months or a year, people are going to say, how much money did you spend? And where's the documentation for that? So what we've actually incorporated there is what they call an electronic field book. So we've had that on site since I took this office, essentially. And now, in this way, through the lead engineering firm, we've got it so that they're really trying to track time and materials, the equipment that's on site. I mean, if you're not using the equipment, there's a different rate than if you are using the equipment for their depreciation schedules, all these kinds of things. So we're really trying to track to the best of our ability. Plus, this really does help from a accounting matrix for Vicki's purposes for trying to document what we're spending here.
Excellent.
It's not perfect, though. It's not a perfect thing, but we're doing best we can.
Very good. It's comforting to know that. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anyone else? Commissioner Drolet.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I recognize our top priority here is to approve this resolution and solve the problem. You mentioned there hadn't been inspections for a great period of time. Do you know if those inspections are required or just something that's a good practice? Was there an ordinance broken, a law broken, or just a general bad practices?
Well, you know, there's apparently some industry standards for inspections. Whether or not that was adhered to here, I'm not sure yet. But that being said, if you had a line of pipe that has already had two red flags on the field, don't you think you might want to inspect it a little bit more often? I mean, I don't know. That would just seem to me. One thing I can tell you going forward, we intend to do a very comprehensive audit of all the underground that is under the jurisdiction of my purview. And we're going to look at the inspection logs, and we're just going to start, not to get off the far field here, but if you ever had a chance to go in the Public Works Department, you will find there is room after room after room of paper. Everything is, nothing has been really digitized. And I'm not kidding. It looks like the Twilight Zone to me. It's all this paper is there, and somehow we need to digitize all of that. That's going to be a longer-term project. But part of that will be able, you know, you get your iPhone, you're going to be out there, you're going to start, when was this inspected, what kind of anomalies might have been found, what kind of pipe are you actually looking at, who was the last guy who worked on it, blah, blah. There's a lot of things that can be done. And one thing I will also tell you, talking to our great neighbors of Oakland County, they actually insure their underground. They insure their underground, which is a more common practice for a large county. Now, why we have never insured our underground here, I don't know. But we don't have any insurance for it. That's another thing we're going to be looking at long-term for all of our underground. We need to be thinking about this because, I mean, you insure your car.
This might be a follow-up for another day because I know, again, the top priority is addressing the issue of getting it fixed. But it's just a question of whether we have, this is a case, what percentage of this is bad luck, bad soils and that sort of thing, what percentage of this is negligence, and is there any criminal negligence involved, you know, over time?
It's speculative, yes. Well, I mean, I don't know. As I say, there's plenty of finger pointing going on, I guess, but we need to think about, as you say, in the immediacy, how we solve this, how we go forward, and then in a very comprehensive way. Because I'll tell you what, this may not be the only underground issue that I come before you on, all right? I'm aware of another one right now. Nothing like this, but where there's some odd things happening. And we're just going to look at everything. And one thing I will commit to you all right now is I will be extremely transparent and accountable. So I invite you to call me anytime. I'll tell you the answer to the best of my knowledge. I might not know the answer, but it was mentioned about contracting the net. There's not been a great history of contracting and through the bidding process in this department. We went out for bids on just the temporary bypass, and we bid it in two ways. We didn't have time to post it and, you know, put an ad in the paper or something, but we bid, like I said, we are going to bid everything we could possibly bid here. So we bid the actual construction of the bypass. We also bid separately the pipes themselves. Because I said, you know what, if we have to do the next section of this pipe, if we decide we are going to do this, why have the contractor own the pipe? We'll own the pipe, right? Well, then we'll be ahead for the next thing. So we're trying to think it through here a bit.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Leonetti.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Again, welcome, Commissioner Miller. Thank you for your transition going from Congress to this and starting your job before you even really started January 1st, being out there on Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. I want to get back to the electronic monitoring system. You did elaborate a little bit on that. Is that information checked daily? Is that something that's checked daily? And
yes.
Who checks that data? Is it somebody from your office that checks that?
Well, we have several staff on site. There's always somebody there, usually two or three, from our department. And Anderson Eckstein Westrick, AEW, is the lead engineer. They're not the only engineer on site. A fellow named Lou Urban will be the guy that will be giving you the brief on Sunday. And they've got a system now. They're checking it every day. And they say everybody's getting pretty good about, you know, now they're getting used to the program here of documenting all of that. We do have other engineers on site, though, besides them. And once we get this bypass built, we're going to bid the project, the construction. We may be bidding the engineering services also. We might not. There might be a real value in the continuity or bidding different sections of it, surveying some of the different kinds of things that might be happening. So, but again, we'll be extremely transparent of what is happening there.
Is that thank you for that. Is that data, does that give us a raw number, like on a weekly basis, on how much we're spending? I'm just wondering how long it takes from when you get the data to somebody digests and says, okay, we're at $1 million this week, we're at $3 million, you know, next week. Is that the way that electronic monitoring system works? Does it give us that kind of data?
I really don't know the answer to that question. I'm not sure exactly how it's uploaded and exactly the extent of it all on a daily basis, but I'll get back to you on that.
Okay, thank you, Commissioner. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Commissioner Kleinfeld.
Thank you, Chair. Baptism by fire.
Yes.
Welcome.
Thank you.
I was actually surprised that the pipe was 55 feet below. I didn't know that we had pipes 55 feet below ground level. And that one doesn't service my community. Are there other pipes that size and of that nature throughout the rest of Macomb County?
Yes, although I'm not a total expert on this yet. Okay, I'm only into week two. but I have been looking at all the schematics and that. And yes, there's another system called the OMID, which is the Oakland-Macomb Interceptor District, that is also very large and below ground, about 60 feet below. And quite frankly, that most of that within the borders of Macomb County have been rehabbed, so to speak, with this HOBOS material I was talking about. I think they've spent, I think they said $57 million on lining that pipe. So. But yes, there are others. You know, one other thing for those that are from Warren, Warren has their own system, right? Warren, and you're probably very familiar with it, you fellas, but you also know that that's an old, antiquated system. And Warren, there's been a lot of chatter whether or not Warren would be a member of the OMID, whether they would be a participant of that, or whether you will have your own system. That's yet to be determined. But Warren, let's just say, right? Because of the antiquated system, has been a problem with the Red Run, with Bear Creek, et cetera, one of the worst problems in the county. But hats off to the city council, because just at the end of December, they voted to buck up $52 million for a bonding resolution to do one of two things. I don't think they've quite decided which way they want to go yet. Well, I mean, you're talking about buying an old elementary school and building a retention pond there and various kinds of things, but it's expensive. That's just one city, right? That's just one city, $52 million, and hopefully you can get it for that. So hats off to Warren for at least something's going to happen there now in a very good way. Yeah.
Well, I don't think East Point's lawsuit had anything to do with that decision. No.
Not according to Steve Duchesne, right?
So and my son's on East Point City Council, so yeah.
Oh, okay.
They would take a little bit of credit there.
It's pressure points, right? Pressure points.
So as we go through this process for other meetings, it's been brought to our attention the problems with the lack of retention basins in St. Clair Shores and all of that. I think it would be really helpful after you get a little time in and you have a chance to get on top of this thing, that we have discussions of the other problems you're seeing and the thing in St. Clair Shores. There's different ways to fix it, and I think that there's an interest here to know about the different ways and to be able to ask questions and maybe participate a little bit in that process.
I appreciate that because, you know, with all this sewage, listen, we don't have clean hands in Macomb County, right? And sometimes it's just easier for us to go along here and not get things fixed. And like I say, Warren's a great example now. They're doing the right thing here. But this is, we have pump stations in Macomb County that discharge. Now, they discharge and they say they disinfect to bathable standards is what they call the MDEQ current standards. I will tell you, I was just talking to my friends in Oakland County today, and you may see some of these comments in the paper, because I think the release went out. But I said, you know, you got to be kidding. We are doing everything we can. I mean, I'm getting emails every 2 hours from our guys looking at the flow in this pipe. We have a collapsed sewer. We're looking at the flow in the pipe. We're trying to move the capacity around within the system so we do not have to discharge into the river. And this is all going on, and we're, you know, gosh, every morning, and we go, oh, gosh, that we didn't have to discharge last night, right? That was good. And Oakland County, with this little bit of rain, just discharged out of the George Coon. So they discharged. So they said, well, I said, you get the same amount of rain. We have a collapsed sewer. Well, ours is different because ours is a combined system. And I said, well, that's right. You got to separate your stormwater from your storm sewage. Well, that's too expensive. In fact, I used Warren as an example. I said, Warren is not the most affluent community in the world, and look at what they're doing. And you guys over here, I love Oakland County. You know, I'm glad you all live in huge houses there. But you can't, you're our neighbors, and what you are doing is not neighborly, okay? So you can't keep discharging on us. You have to do something. I know you're not going to change this overnight. And, of course, he said, well, you've got pump stations where you're discharge. I said, I know. And he said, well, it's bathable standards. I said, well, I will stand corrected if you officials in Oakland County go out there at that discharge pipe and take your bath, all right? Go take a bath in it. So if you do that, then no problem.
And the the separation versus retention is exactly one of the discussions that I'm interested in having down the road. I just ask before I relinquish, I have some questions on the appointment that we're going to do on the next agenda item, so if you would stay there with respect to that. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner. Anyone else have any questions? Commissioner Sagar.
Sewage, or is it green water or a combination of everything?
It's mostly sewage.
Mostly sewage.
Yeah, but there is a lot of infiltration now because of this, so yeah, that's why in the heavy rains, right? In the heavy rains. And within all of these communities that are in the mid, not all of them have separated their stormwater from their storm sewage. So we have work to do in Macomb. And you know what? We are going to do it. We're going to figure this out somehow because all of us have children and grandchildren. You just don't want to keep passing this down every generation. It's one of the reasons I ran for this job. I mean, we need to, I understand it's expensive. You're not going to fix it overnight. But you got to have a plan and start working at this. And so does Oakland County, by the way.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Majek.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Candice Miller, I first want to congratulate you on your victory in Public Works Commissioner. Look forward in working with you. And the second thing is, I think your office, executive's office, Vicki, and everyone else involved with the sinkhole has done a fine job From what I see, and I look forward in playing a positive role, what we can do here in the board to help you out with that. What I do want to say to you that kind of pertains to what you said about infrastructure. And you're now elected for 4 years, and you're going to find out a lot about sewers and infrastructure, and I couldn't agree with you more. The lack of spending as it comes to our infrastructure relating to our sewers and roads. And the thing that bothers me about this is, you know, you either pay now or pay later, and there's no free lunches. And I hope that during your tenure here, your four-year tenure as Public Works Commissioner, that as you find out things, you're going to find out a lack of investment. You know, we're not just spending enough in this. And I hope, if I would say one thing new that you would remember, I hope that you will have, political courage to do the right things in terms of letting the residents know, whether it's through taxes, fees, or bonds, that in order for us to upgrade or get our infrastructure to where it needs to be, that there's a cost to that. We either pay, we pay in the future, or we pay now. And we know it's going to cost more if we wait for the future. And you know, I just say this because I care about this deeply. We were at the Mound Road meeting at the gazebo a few weeks ago. I feel very strongly about that, that the state fails in its responsibility to take care of the taxes that relates to as it relates to gas taxes to adequately fix our roads, because all the roads in the whole state are in poor condition. So that's how I would just to leave you at that, Ed, is I hope you'll have political courage in your next 4 years in doing something that may be unpopular. You know, but I think that residents want to live in a safe, clean county, and are willing to pay a little bit more knowing that our infrastructure will be better long term.
So. And I appreciate those comments. You know, one thing that I would really like to see here is a sort of a goal of mine. You know, one of the governor actually just did this 21st Century on Infrastructure Commission. They did sort of a listening tour all over the state. They went to Traverse and they were Grand Rapids and Detroit, et cetera. And one of the themes throughout this is something I've been talking about, is where we have to coordinate with all the affected stakeholders when you have a finite amount of infrastructure investment, so that, and we've all seen it, right? You're driving along Van Dyke, all of a sudden they got to tear up the road. They just did this 3 years ago, right? Now somebody has to put in fiber optics or something else has got to happen here. Anything that we're doing in this county, I think we could be really a role model, certainly for the state, where anything we're doing like that, you have everybody who's impacted, whether it's the city, the county, the state, the federal highways, the utilities, et cetera, to make sure if there's something that has to change while you're tearing this up, we do it in a comprehensive way to let the taxpayers have the best bang for their bucks, and you have a long-term, a better product long-term.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner. Anyone else on the first round? Commissioner Kraft.
Commissioner.
Yes. The guesstimate would be for the whole thing about a year.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Anyone else on the first round? Commissioner, I have a couple things, too, I would like to. First, I'd like to state I've been out to the sinkhole. I've talked to many residents and business owners, and I will just back up what everybody else has been saying. All of the workers out there, everybody has been fantastic. Anything they've needed has been done as far as trying to keep their roads open for business, creating new roads for entry and exit. And I just want to say that I have not heard anything except for positive things about everybody out there working, and they're working in some terrible conditions. And, you know, it's easy to be miserable working at 3 in the morning in, you know, minus, 5-degree weather. And they've never found anybody to be anybody but helpful out there. So just so you know, to reiterate that, all the contractors that you guys have hired have been doing a great job. My question, it comes down to, you know, this affects a lot of people in different varying magnitudes. So, you know, all the residents of the county, are affected to an extent, certainly with the payment of this over the long haul. The businesses on 15 Mile Road in the area start getting it hit in their pocketbooks. But the couple questions I have for you are about the specific and probably the hardest hit, at least right now, the few residents that their houses have been condemned. I know insurance is a sticky issue when it comes down to that. Do you have anything that you could tell us about what might be going on with that?
Well, I can tell you, Chairman, that the three houses that have been condemned, that we do have legal counsel now. That first of all, we had a meeting with all of the residents on that street, and talking to, gave them sheets for reimbursement sheets and different kind of documentation that Vicki needed. And she was there, and then subsequently we've started to have some conversations with the three homes that are condemned. And I know they want an answer immediately, but we've just trying to be figuring out here. First of all, how are we going to proceed? And so we're, as I say, we're in the process, of getting appraisals done. And we hope to be able to come to an agreement with these folks and purchase those homes is really our plan. We'll see what happens, and I'm hopeful that that no one thinks that they need to go to court, which at that point, I guess sort of all bets are off, right? But we're trying to do the right thing. We're trying to be compassionate to these families. And we understand that they don't have insurance. And I think for the most part, most of us think that this is probably the right thing to do. We'll just have to see how it goes. But I'll tell you, the one lady, I was at the Fraser Town Hall the other night, Monday night, I guess it was. I'm losing track of my days here. This woman, it was just, came up to the microphone, gave her name and address and started talking about, she said, I'm a single mother with four children and a dog, and I'm living in a hotel room. And this was my dream home. And I can't live in this hotel. You got to help me. And I tell you, these are real people. They're our neighbors, right? They're our neighbors. So.
Thank you. I know personally and as a board, I'm sure everybody appreciates the way that you're going about this for these people. That's it for my questions. I believe we have Commissioner Brown on the second round.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One thing for Sunday, some of us will be going out. If we get a breakdown on how the percentage of users, like Washington Township, a certain percentage of this problem, and Chesterfield and so forth. As I was talking to my supervisor O'Leary, and he had a number that he had thrown out that he was given by someone that said, well, Washington Township's X percent of the use of this pipe, and therefore we anticipate this dollar amount to be spread over our users. If we had something like that to show the scope of where that type of information is, so we can all understand, from our areas, if it happens to be one of our areas, what the burden will be in terms of cost, that'd be helpful to us. As well as you also mentioned some potential funding sources that may be out there at all levels of government. If you could maybe have some of that for us too, if you could, if you have it available, that'd be helpful for us too, so we could all hit the ground running and support your effort to try to secure those necessary funds. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Commissioner, for coming.
Thank you. If no one else has anything to... Oh, I'm sorry. Commissioner Tocco.
Thank you. I don't have any questions. This is probably the third or fourth meeting I've been to this week, but I do want to tell the other board members that Commissioner Miller has been very visible in the district. Your team and all of your department has been there. And the residents of the city of Fraser are very grateful for that. There's a lot of discussion on that and just how visible and helpful your department has been. And I'd also like to remind my colleagues on the board that there are some businesses that are being impacted significantly. And to remind you to please try and patronize those businesses. The last time that we had a sinkhole, one of the restaurants on that strip of 15 Mile went out of business, and the Green Lantern just moved in to that area. There's a couple strip malls with some smaller stores in there, so if you could kind of try to direct some of your business over that way, the residents would appreciate that, and I'm sure the businesses would as well.
If I could, Commissioner Tocco, let me also just tell you, and you, we didn't have to tell you, you already knew the kind of community you represent there. That town hall of the residents of Fraser that are impacted, and I'll tell you what, as an old township supervisor, and I've been to a lot of public hearings or public meetings over the years, I was so incredibly impressed with how these folks, under these kind of challenges, handled themselves. I mean, they talked very calmly. They asked their questions very professionally, well thought out. They've got some anxiety, of course, but the way that they all handled themselves speaks volumes to the kind of people that they are. And I was just so incredibly impressed by all of them.
Thank you. If no one else is wishing to speak, thank you, Commissioner Miller.
Thank you. Thank you all. Yes. Look forward to working with you.
Great. Thanks. So we have a motion on the floor and an amendment. So Corporation Counsel tells me that we should first vote on the motion, original motion. I'm sorry. So the amendment is to continue and renew the Macomb County State of Emergency Declaration until February 9th for the sewer collapse sinkhole emergency initially declared on January 5th, 2017 by the county executive. So all in favor of voting yes on this amendment, please vote on your device. Motion passed 12 to 0. Nope.
It recorded her vote.
It did record your vote. Thank you. So motion passes unanimously. Now we're going to vote on the motion as amended to extend it to February 9th. All in favor, please vote on your iPad, or all opposed, please vote on your iPad. The amendment also passes 12 to 0, so the motion has passed. The extension is good until February 9th. Thank you. Next on the agenda is the appointment of Brian Santo to the Drainage Board. This is an appointment by the County Executive's Office with concurrence of the board. Deputy Executive Lorenzo is here. Would you like to speak briefly on this? I know Brian Santo could not make it to this meeting. We're mostly all familiar with him, but if you'd like to speak just for a moment before we gotta.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The appointment of Brian Santo, I think most of you, at least all but five of you, may be familiar with him because he was approved just 2 months ago by this body as the director of the Department of Roads. One of the things that the executive has hoped to do in his long-range plan is to try to bring the two major infrastructure components of county government into closer alignment. Those two key infrastructure components would be the Department of Public Works and the Department of Roads. And I think that when you look at how those interact, you can barely do anything to a road that doesn't have something to do with a drain or a sewer, and you can barely do anything with a drain or a sewer that doesn't have something to do with the Department of Roads. So in order to try to bring better collaboration, better operation into this new drain board configuration, what the executive said is, if we appoint the director of the Department of Roads to work alongside the Commissioner of Public Works, you're going to get a much higher degree of collaboration than we've ever had in the past. And so that really is what has motivated his desire to appoint Brian to serve in this capacity.
Great, thank you. We're to get the motion out of the way here. We need a motion to support this.
I'll make the motion.
Supported by Commissioner Brown, seconded by Commissioner Leonetti. Are there any questions for Commissioner Tocco?
Thank you. The Drainage Board is the board that meets of three people?
Correct.
Okay.
Yes.
And what's the makeup of that board? I know that previously
it's changing, actually. Legislation was just signed into law recently that changed that as it impacts a charter county. The configuration going forward will be and it's still called drain commissioner in the statute. Our charter combines the role of drain commissioner with public works commissioner. So Commissioner Miller will be a member of that board or her designee. An appointment of the executive confirmed by the commission will be a second member. But what the really unique twist is that the third member will be a member of the Board of Commissioners whose district residents pay the highest allocation to that particular drainage cost. In the past, it had been a fixed appointment of the board chair and the chair of the finance committee, but that would mean that two commissioners could be serving on that drain board but have really no direct interest in the parties affected by any costs related to the drain. So in this particular case, let me use this as an example of how I personally think and the executive thinks this legislation is an improvement. Commissioner Brown asked about allocations for the MID, the Macomb Interceptor Drainage District. The community that currently pays the highest allocation toward the MID and therefore may have the highest costs related to the MID repair work is the city of Sterling Heights. I think there is more than one commissioner from the city of Sterling Heights. I don't know yet if there is a mechanism that would determine which of those commissioners would serve, but the point of it is a commissioner from the district most affected economically will now be a member of that board. And so that's the new construct.
Great.
So that's does that commissioner keep rotating?
Every drain in the county will be identified with a commissioner's district, and when something impacts that drainage district, that commissioner will be part of the decision-making process.
So in the past, when I have attended drain board meetings, there may be three agendas, and there are three drainage districts having agendas that day.
Yes.
So there could be three different commissioners required at that meeting?
The logistics of that, Commissioner, I don't know that that's been thought through. This bill was only signed into law this week. But what we want to do is be positioned to have that new statute respected in the drain board configuration going forward, because sooner or later, the Macomb Interceptor Drain District will have to begin making some decisions and we'll need a board to act on that.
Okay. And so then Brian would be the executive's office appointment to that?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Commissioner Kleinfeld.
Thank you. Now, I think we learned during the campaign that there was a portion of Macomb County that didn't go through any drain board because the county commissioners gave the authority to the public works director like in 1970-something. Do you know, are you aware of what I'm talking about?
Not in detail, but I know essentially of that authority, yes.
Does that not apply? Is the sinkhole in those communities, are they not? I thought they were part of that that did not originally go through the drain board.
With the assistance of Corporation Council over time, that has to be sorted out. But what I can tell you is this. The physical assets of that sewer, of the Macomb Interceptor Drain District, those assets are owned by a drain board, a drainage board. What was called the Macomb County Wastewater Disposal District provides services to that drain and other drains, but it is not the owner of the assets. It is not the owner of the pipe.
Okay, so.
And I would ask Corporation Council to assist on some of this.
Is there any section of the county where there wasn't a drain district that owned the pipes? The County Board of Commissioners turned authority over to the Public Works Commissioner. And one of the things that was on my agenda, and it didn't matter what the outcome of the election was that oversight be restored. And then this law came down from Lansing, so we may be able to restore oversight, but it won't come to us. That was really my question, and it may be something you have to work out, but we need to find out if this commission needs to actually cast a vote to retrieve that control or if the law from the state supersedes that.
I have an answer. It's going to be kind of hyper-technical, but I think you're referring to the Act 342 appointment by the boards decades ago of the drain commissioner as the county's agency. That's statutory language. The drain commissioner was appointed to be the county's agency, and that authority is oversight back to this board on everything, just the county projects.
Okay.
Which ones those are?
Well, I thought that the Oakland thing was, it was not just a county project, and I thought the whole reason for the hiring of attorneys and there not being the approval and all of that sort of stuff had specifically to do with the fact that the county had turned that authority over. If I'm mistaken on that, that's fine. But just if you could, as we're creating this situation, because this is what I was the most interested in, is how are we going to deal with this new drain board change?
Right. Let me try to answer that. And Corporation Council and I have had multiple discussions on this, and it's incredibly complex. We're not going to run away from that either, but it's very complex. For a drainage district, a drainage district is a legal entity. It's brought about by petitioning process of communities. Those petitions are then acknowledged by the drain commissioner, and at that point it's given life as a legal entity. As many of those as there may be in Macomb County, I don't know the exact number, but as many of those as there are, those legal entities will all have, like they had in the past, a three-person board, but with just a little different composition. And so for this particular case, the concern about appointing the executive appointment, having it confirmed, is so that the Macomb Interceptor Drain Drainage District, the one that owns the pipe that has ruptured, will have the board in place to oversee the operation. As the Corporation Council said, the agency that was granted actually in 1966 to the Public Works Commissioner is an agency that would apply, as he said, to a county project as opposed to a drainage district project. So that's not running away from it. It's a very complex set of circumstances that have to be analyzed very carefully.
All right, I think that the rest of my questions relative to that might be one-on-one with our attorney. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Duje.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is fine that Brian, good afternoon. Brian will be the executive member of the drainage board. That being said, none of this takes effect for 90 days past New Year's, correct?
Correct. That's at least my understanding.
Yes, 90 days. There's a 90-day effective date from the date of signing by the government.
Okay, so even if they wanted to do that, it's not bad to get Brian possibly up to speed on this, but as far as making decisions, votes, or otherwise, they can't do much of anything going forward past what has been done for 90 days. Is that correct?
Well, currently, the new statute doesn't take effect for 90 days, so we're still under the old statute.
Right.
And the three-member board would be the Public Works Commissioner,
Chair
Smith, and then I believe it's Commissioner Kleinfeld is the
Chair of Finance.
Chair. Yeah. And that will be the composition of the drain board for the next 86 days.
Till the passage of 90 days from January 1st.
Correct. Correct.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that we had that in place and that everybody understands that. And if I'm not mistaken, going to Commissioner Toko's question, I think there will be different commissioners, yes, depending on how much of the pipe or how much of whatever is in whoever's district. So that's going to be, I'm not sure who's going to make that determination. I think Public Works probably will, but let's see how it goes. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay, we have a motion before us made by Commissioner Brown, seconded by Commissioner Leonetti, to approve the appointment of Brian Santos to the Drainage Board. Commissioners, please vote. That appointment is approved 12-0. Thank you, commissioners. Next item on the agenda is new business. Any commissioners have any new business? I'd like to make one announcement, and I made it before, but just for the sake of the commissioners that had to show up a little bit late and also the commissioners that are missing, that this meeting was just called yesterday. This was not on the meeting schedule, so I just want to make everybody aware of that. All right, any other New business, we're up to public participation. 5 minutes. Any member of the public wishing to speak?
Hello again, members of the Board of Commissioners. I thought that was a great discussion there. And I guess I'll go back to the original 12, 13 million gallons of sewage that was dumped into the Clinton River. During that transition period, as you know, the old Public Works Commissioner was on vacation at the time, and due to the declaration of the emergency where the Macomb County stepped in on behalf of Fraser to work with the issue, I guess obviously those engineers were already in place and the contractors were already in place and everything was already in place. And this goes back to the original question of who gave the AOK, the person or the agency, to dump the sewage into the Clinton River. But like I say, the matter does come down to, this is part of the Macomb County Wastewater Disposal District. I got a nice map from the Oakland County website. The Oakland County website is very open and transparent when it comes down to all the information you need to know about the drains in Oakland County, and we're afraid to ask, including a lot of that Chapter 21 inter-county drain communication with the Public Works Commissioner of Macomb County, Oakland County, and the appointee by the state. I guess the real question comes down to is there's 960 drains, and this formula is going to be very complex. One of the big things that I did last year about this time is I asked from my senator and my House of Representative person for a 100-page copy of the drain code, and just to see if I was, if the one that was online was out of date. And of course, I learned quite a bit along the way regarding what was not done at the county level. Commissioner Drolet had mentioned, is there criminal negligence that could possibly be addressed as far as if the drains are not attended to? And more so, I think that the forensic audit that was suggested during the campaign trail will free up some money. But when I look at my tax bill, I'm being charged 0.005 mills for what's considered to be county drain debt. And that seems rather light. The idea behind these special assessment districts, bonds outstanding right now is $84 million. So if we're talking about a $100 million project, that would almost like double. So like I say, it's going to be very interesting. One of the fun things on the campaign trail last year, besides looking at charts and graphs and funds and stuff, is to the issue of bringing up what is wrong with the actual hiddenness of the Public Works Commissioner Department. And I feel good that basically Candice Miller will be showing openness and transparency. I guess the major thing there is I would like to see the bonding go out to bids and not the same guy that we've had for 20, 25 years that seems to fund everybody's campaign. I'll just stop talking right now, but criminal neglect, I think that would be really the issue, especially when you have an operational department up until December 31st, and that somebody who ran the department told his employees, don't talk to the new people. And I consider that to be criminal neglect. It seems to be a trend here in the county, but that's just sort of the way it is when people lose an election and go on vacation. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members from the public wishing to speak? Any other members of the public wishing to speak? With that, clerk, would you please call the roll?
Brown?
Yes.
Cabelli? Absent. Drolet? Duzé?
Here.
Kleinfeld?
Here.
Kraft?
Here.
Lennon? Lucido? Magic?
Here.
Romano?
Here.
Sauger?
Here.
Smith?
Here.
Tope?
Here.
Okay. Great. Motion to adjourn by Commissioner Duge, seconded by Commissioner Leonetti. All in favor? Aye. We are adjourned.